I mean, Skinner, it's SWN podcast, I guess, if you want.
And welcome to the season finale of the SWN podcast. As we do every year, it is my birthday when this episode comes out, July 2nd, 2023. It's not a good start to the episode when I can't remember my own birthday year. It is the quiz. It's the day of birth bonanza. And I'm looking forward to this. We have contestants from numerous seasons of the podcast. I'm a professional would have written them down, but I didn't this year because, you know, I don't care. Right, okay. So I will introduce you all to the guests. This won't be great for the audio content, but above me is the champion, the reigning champion, who may or may not appear because it seems like he's glitching out every time his video goes on. It is the reigning defending Day of Birth Bonanza champion, Brent Carter. Is your audio working?
Hello.
Hey.
Go. Oh, he speaks. God damn it.
Still looking like a Black Mirror episode, though.
Yeah.
You all suck.
And to his right, or whichever way I'm pointing, it is the self-proclaimed greatest 19-year-old wrestler in professional wrestling. It is Ronan King.
Yeah, baby. Woohoo!
So it's going to be a long 2 hours.
So it's the last time Ronan was on, we got the scoop that he wears his mother's jacket. And since then, he has assaulted members of the crowd with the guitars. He has swore more in front of people, and he stabbed someone in the eye. So it's been a great time since we last spoke to Ronan King on the podcast.
They all deserved it. All deserved it.
And to the other side. Nope, that side. It is the Asian sensation back, I think, for his fifth or sixth appearance on the podcast, is Umar Mohammed.
Boo!
Shut the fuck up.
Fuck off, Umar.
I don't know if we're allowed to swear on this, but just for more for Ronan, shut the fuck up.
Swearing. I know if we're allowed to swear on this, but you opened up with shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
This is going swimmingly so far.
Yeah.
It's gone great.
To my right, it is the YouTube sensation. With his millions of viewership and thousands of subscribers. He's back again. You heard him 2 weeks ago on the actual podcast itself, where we talked about Guardians of the Galaxy. It is Alex Webb.
Get a real job.
You called him YouTube Sensation there. Sensation's trademark, so you're going to have to cut that.
Oh, this is going to be a long fucking 2 hours.
And to my left, he's returning again for his third appearance on the podcast, the rad lad Gaz Williams.
What up?
Go. Below, I've got two guests who had mixed fortunes last time on the Day of Birth Bonanza. One ended dead last. That is the Titanium himself, Tom Atlas.
The fridge was fucking cold. Why?
In an episode which could be also called Tom Atlas got bullied for 2 hours. And to his right of the screen, it is the man who finished second, if I remember rightly, last year. It is, he's still doing the wrestling, he's still doing the quizzes. It's Grant McIvor.
Second comes straight after first.
Not first, you're last. So, here we are.
The Simpsons reference.
I don't watch Simpsons. You know, if anyone's seen the thumbnail, because I'm not changing it, there should have been two more guests, Nathan North and Nicole Jasmine. Unfortunately, they both informed me they had family emergencies. Whether it's the same emergency, I don't know. But they will know they're unable to appear. So we've just got this rabble in the quiz. So I think that guarantees, because they're still in the lineup, they're finishing dead last. So that means Tom's not going to finish last on this particular quiz.
So he'll find it a way.
Unless I start dishing out minus points. So
yeah, you're not wrong, probably.
So we've got five rounds, including a video round, which is curated by Reese Dawkins himself, which may or may not happen, depending on, you know, if I can actually get it to work. Because as it's been established already, I don't know how to share screen very well. So here we go. Very simple. Lots of wrestling in this particular quiz this year. And this is the season finale. This is, of course, going to be the big celebration for the podcast, and I'm going to take a big break because, you know, I've done 200 and whatever, it was 209th episode, I think, something like that. I think that's enough for my voice for a little bit. So are we all ready? Any questions? Anything you want to get off your chest before we start the quiz?
I'm wondering why Omar's name is spelt wrong on the thing.
I mean, Omar, it's my name. I don't understand.
No, but Omar, you've spelt it U-M-A-R-M.
Omar.
I don't know if you realize that, but that's an M.
Yeah, M at the end.
Yeah. What's your point?
Is that how you spell your name? I thought it was just four letters, not five.
I mean, surely as well with surnames, you have a little capital letter.
Oh, my bad. All right, never mind.
So, come on.
It's Umar. God. Right, so we've got 10 questions to start off with. It's a wrestling round, and of course, I've named it after one of the greatest wrestling podcasts of all time. It's called Let's Talk Wrestling. Of course, everyone will know about that podcast, and
IP.
The greatest three episodes you'll ever listen to. Oh, no, two. The third one was shite. Anyway, everyone got pen and paper ready? That's for everyone not watching the video, is no. One person has not got pen and paper, so we'll wait for Gaz.
I wasn't prepared. Oh, yeah, actually, hold on. Yeah.
Right.
All right.
Nope.
Professional boys. We're doing well here.
Hey, got some.
Okay. Ready. Right. So, 10 questions, first round, and then we'll go over the answers afterwards. Nice and simple start off with. Who was the 100th person to hold the WWE Intercontinental Championship? Okay. You need to read it again? Are you quite happy?
Is this like in terms of reigns or just like the first ever run with it?
Oh, just the 100th person. Hang on. No, okay. Yeah, in reigns. Yeah, reigns.
Oh, God, that changes it.
The 100th person to have held it?
Yeah. So if it could be their third reign, it could be their fourth, but they're 100 in the lineage of the title. And I'm panicking that I've got that wrong, because, hang on, I will double check while everyone's answering.
I guess I'll play to the odds.
It's a good start when the first question gets questioned.
Knowing Grant, he obviously will probably win it because he probably knows his stuff because he does this for warm-ups.
All Grant's answers are going to be Eddie Guerrero.
Yeah, probably.
I mean, if the question is who is behind me right now and there.
Right,
I have Eddie Guerrero's behind me right now, so probably yes.
I have confirmed it is the 100th reign.
Reign.
Yeah. Okay.
Does a vacant reigns count in this?
I'm quite confident in my answer here. Quite confident.
We're gonna say no for vacant count.
Love you too, Ronan. Love you too.
Right. Question two. And in a similar vein. Who was the first WWF Intercontinental Champion? They're not all about the Intercontinental Championship. That's just how the questions have ended up.
This is really testing my wrestling knowledge, because
just you wait till Ian Skinner's round. That's...
Maybe I should. I probably should know this, but
Question three: what was the former name of John Cena's finisher, the Attitude Adjustment? Just easing you in with all these questions. I don't think. I mean, the first one's a bit of a bastard, to be honest, but the rest of them are quite straightforward. Question four. What? Okay, right. Question four. Right, every time I say someone's interrupting me, is it Brent?
It's Brent. Kick him out.
God damn it, Brent.
It's not me, because I'm muted.
Jesus Christ, that Black Mirror episode keeps on coming back.
Right, okay. Let's go play on through. Question four. Which 7 foot tall wrestler was called the eighth wonder of the world?
Maybe no bump.
Okay, question five. Who was the first Nexus leader? Silence there is concentration. Question six. What year did the first WrestleMania take place? Question seven. Really should number them at the side there. At WrestleMania 2000, who was in the corner of the Big Show in the main event? Question eight. Who did Edge defeat to win the 2001 King of the Ring? Question nine. Which female wrestler was the first to hold the Raw and SmackDown Women's Championships? And I feel like someone's going to ask this not at the same time.
Oh, great.
Question, by the way, Billy. Does spelling count here? Because I feel like my dyslexia is really kicking in now.
Well, as we're going by an honor system, if you got it right, you just put your hand up after. How do we?
I wouldn't trust Ronan. Do not trust Ronan. Do not trust Ronan.
Alex, on fucking bomb. Shut the fuck up.
Make me, bitch.
Aww.
And the final question of this round, number 10. Who is the only wrestler to hold the WWE Championship, the WCW Championship, and the ECW Championship? Although, judging by his TikTok, that might be a question that's just built for Grant.
Yeah, I think this was a clue, right enough.
Yeah, could you repeat that, Billy?
Yeah, to be fair, I had no idea you said that.
Last one. Okay. Who is the only wrestler to hold the WWE Championship, the WCW Championship, and the ECW Championship? Brent Screen's giving me the creeps.
You could easily do a green screen on that, to be fair, though.
Yeah, you can.
No, that's wrong.
Okay, right. So I think we're all right. Do you need any repeated? No. Right, we're all right. Okay.
I think yes. Okay, I'm working.
Okay, so first question was: who was the 100th person to hold the WWE Intercontinental Championship? Alex has put his hand up.
I wrote Frankie Mooney, aka the best wrestler in the world.
Unfortunately, he wasn't able to fit into his schedule. Anyone else?
You're too busy in Japan. Yeah.
Brent?
I'm just taking a guess at Jericho.
Incorrect. Anyone else want to go?
I said Kofi Kingston.
Oh, Gaz?
Razor Ramon?
No, and I'll shock you what year it was. It was Edge.
Yes.
Destin 4. So, so Grant got it. Everyone, water system, hand up.
I was 0 years old in 2004, so you can't.
I was 14, shut your face. So Grant was the only one that got the answer right. Excellent. Question two, who was the first WWF Intercontinental Champion? Brent?
Pat Patterson.
Correct, Pat Patterson. All right, so hands up. So Brent? Oh, everyone, excellent. Get the old Excel spreadsheet out. And question three, what was the former name of John Cena's finisher, the Attitude Adjustment? Tom?
F you.
Go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
Tom?
Get in the fridge.
Yeah.
It was F you. Everyone get that?
Yeah.
Otherwise known as Fuck Omar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yeah, that was a clue that Ronan was given the whole time.
Question four. Which 7-foot-tall wrestler was called the 8th Wonder of the World? Surely everyone's got this. Brent?
Andre the Giant.
It was Andre the Giant. Again, everyone?
Yep.
Brent. This is going very well so far. It's very competitive.
I didn't get that. I didn't get that right.
Did you put Frankie Mooney?
No, I wrote Great Khali because my brain just doesn't compute sometimes.
I didn't get that either.
I loved Great Khali, so yeah, that's a win in my eyes.
Right, so Omar got it wrong as well. Yeah.
I put Andre the Giant.
Oh, it is.
I put Andre as well.
Right, okay. Excellent. This is going well. Question, next one is, who was the first Nexus leader?
Wade Barrett.
Wade Barrett, yeah. Everyone got Wade Barrett?
Wade Barrett.
Wasn't it serious?
It unfortunately was not. I miss Serios. Right, okay. It's still alive, I assume. What year did the first WrestleMania take place, Brent?
1985.
Yes.
1985, correct.
I know this because I asked, and everyone says it's 1984 because, WrestleMania 20, so that was 20 years ago. Forgetting one.
Right, so who
I think it was Gaz that actually got that wrong as well.
Mm-hmm. Right. Who got that right then?
Yo.
Just the threes.
I just added.
What the fuck did Ronan get that right?
Yeah.
that was the most surprising.
All you think of is, when was WrestleMania 21? Okay, take away 20.
Oh, that's actually quite... Oh, shit.
I just did...
What the fuck did I do that?
My maths might be off then. I don't want to say. I got 1984.
Ah, so close. WrestleMania 2000, but not close enough. WrestleMania 2000, who was in the corner of the Big Show in the main event? Tom?
Shane McMahon?
It was Shane McMahon.
Fuck yes!
Grant, everyone got that? I'm
afraid about that.
Yeah.
The real best
Excellent.
The man with the best quads in the business.
Yeah.
And that Walt Disney mustache.
What?
Oh, I was trying to make a Vince McMahon joke.
Oh. I was like, I don't remember Shane having a mustache. Anyway, right, okay. Question eight. Who did Edge defeat to win the 2001 King of the Ring? Brent?
Kurt Angle.
Kurt Angle, yes.
Didn't get that one.
Alright, so Gaz didn't get that one. Anyone else? Everyone else get it?
I got it.
I put test.
I put test as well.
Yeah, I didn't get it.
Right. And for ultimate question for the round, which female wrestler was the first to hold the Raw and SmackDown Women's Championships?
Alexa Bliss.
It was Alexa Bliss. And everyone get that?
Yeah.
Was it Frankie Mooney? Was that your answer? Or?
It was Scully, but you know, close.
Scully doesn't conform to genders, so fair enough. And the final question of that round: who is the only wrestler to hold the WWE Championship, the WCW Championship, and ECW Championship? Brent.
Big Show.
It was the Big Show.
It's the Big Show.
Can everyone get it?
I actually put Eddie Guerrero.
I put Chris Jericho for some reason.
I put RVD for some reason.
Shocking. Absolutely shocking. Does nobody remember Cyber Sunday or Taboo Tuesday?
That was Cyber a six. Sunday. Cyber Sunday had a stick set, to be fair.
Yes.
Yeah, really bad.
Right. Big fucking like computer screen.
I'm going to do the tally up and I'll read out the scores. And of course, you guys will tell me I'm wrong. So I assume that you're counting it up as well. So give me a second. Talk amongst yourselves. I'll do that.
Oh, boys, we're doing well here. The fucking dead silence, aren't we? Jesus Christ.
I'm literally, my hands are literally just sweating because...
Brent, I can't wait to take it from you. I can't wait to take it from you.
I mean... as long as Tom doesn't, I don't care. Like,
I can dominate all of you.
Brent, it's fine. Just get him to do a shooting star press and it won't be a fucking issue.
Hey, you shut.
I drew a picture of you, Ronan. I drew a picture of you.
Right. So according to my wonderful counting, I have in first place with 10 points, a full house, was Grant McIvor. Fuck. Right, which one did you get wrong?
Number 9. I wrote Charlotte.
Okay. In first, joint first honest. Place. I don't know, I respect the honor system. Right, I'll put 90, that's definitely wrong. 9. Okay, so joint first place. It is Grant McIvor and the reigning champion, Brent Carter.
Yep.
Excellent, with 9 points. In second is Ronan King with 8.
Oh, Billy, you've got that way wrong, man.
Oh, fuck's sake. Right, okay, what'd you get?
5.
Fuck's sake. Okay, well wrong. This is why we should have done the hands up thing, and I haven't forced it yet.
We did!
Yeah.
I wasn't looking, clearly. Right, okay, he's got 5.
You've got glasses. Come on.
Glasses could only help so much. I've got Tom with 7.
Fuck no!
What'd Tom get?
Right, can everyone just give their scores?
Yeah, that's probably easier.
Yeah.
We'll go with that. So, Tom, what'd you get? 5.
5.
All right, so new rules. I'm not counting anymore. I'm just, you're telling me the scores.
Fucking hell, boys.
Omar?
I got 6.
Oh, I got yours, right? Sweet. Okay, Gaz?
7.
7.
I got 2, right? Yeah. Right, who missed out? Alex?
I got 6.
I got yours. Okay, I got the back end right. I just got the top ones wrong. Okay.
You know what? Here's the thing, Billy. Me and Mr. Tom Atlas are too busy working out our massive biceps, not our brains. That's why we're last.
Exactly. Exactly.
Get also, a fucking room. Get a fucking room, you two. Oh, fuck's sake.
From Alex Webb.
Did you spell from with 2 M's?
Oh, no. I had to scribble one out because it was too bad.
No, you spelled it with 2 M's. Stop it.
From... See, if you tried to spell 2 M's, surely you'd score the end off.
Yeah, at least I can spell my name right on this thing. Omar M.
I mean, sensation now. A sensation now.
Doesn't matter. You can't see them on the YouTube anymore.
No, you cannot. I've
switched off. Can you not?
No.
Oh, God, my...
No, the shit. Last time we made a whole bunch of like in-jokes during it, and then we watched it play back and nothing.
No, because I turned them off because some reason it put it on, and I was speaking to London Love. Lust, and it had their real name on it, and I thought that's very awkward for everyone, so I had to take it off. I haven't switched back on because you know some people come in with their shoot names, and there we are. Very boring story. Let's move on. Round 2. I couldn't think of a funny name for it, so it's called "We're Making Movies, Pal." Quote, of course, from the greatest of all time, Vince McMahon.
Such good shit.
It's a movie round. Nice for the wrestling. So, question 1. Jodie Foster sings "My Name is Tallulah" in which 1976 film?
Sorry, what the fuck have you done? Why?
Yay. I know this one.
Just you wait.
What's the song? Sorry?
The song is
"My Name is Tallulah."
The song is "My Name is Tallulah." Nobody click that out of me just saying my name is Tallulah. Thank you, please.
My name is Tallulah. Had a train in North Carolina.
Are these all like wrestling movies or is it like
movies?
No.
It's a musical. It's a musical.
I like to mix it up a little bit. Like I said, it's the most wrestling content in this quiz ever, though, so but this round is not.
It's the weirdest thing, because I love how she did that film the same year she did Taxi Driver.
Yeah,
so
stark
contrast
between the two.
So, in one role, she's playing this character, and in the other one, a teenage prostitute.
There's a clue for you.
Literally, what the ladies wish I was.
Teenage prostitute.
Yeah, sadly, I'm not.
Ron, do you get the connotations of it?
Major, thank you very much.
Can we put out? Can we put out?
Rowan, we can't hear you. Speak out. I mean, speak up.
What the fuck?
Right, my internet went unstable for a second there, and that was the joke that it came back with. So I'm very happy with that. Mm. Next question. Cool Runnings tells the story of which country entering a bobsleigh team into the 1988 Winter Olympics in Calgary? Nothing says up to the minute and on the pulse like a film from 1988.
Was that really? Oh my god.
I mean, I don't think the film came out in 1988, but.
No. I was going to say, I was sure it was a 90s thing.
Most people say, you know, we can't believe.
Question three. According to the Princess Diaries, what fruit is Genovia famous for?
Yes.
Sorry, could you repeat that, Billy?
According to the Princess Diaries, what fruit is Genovia famous for? A wonderful film. Anne Hathaway at her best. Question four. Three of Jim Carrey's blockbusters, The Mask, Dumb and Dumber, and Ace Ventura, Pet Detective, were all released in what year?
Oh, fuck.
What, between 2 years or so? Remember when you've been absolutely fucking busy for them?
So the movies again, quickly.
The Mask, Dumb and Dumber, and Ace Ventura, Pet Detective.
Right, I think that's the last one.
Yes. I'm torn because I did Truman Show come out after those films or before those films?
Absolutely after. Yeah,
much after. All right. Well, in that case, then, cheers, boys.
Okay, and the longest question I've got to read, so good luck, everyone. The movie includes a titular track from Kenny Loggins. Kevin Bacon performs much of his character's dancing, and John Lithgow leads a charge to band dancing. All of this occurs in what 1984 film? We're all going good. That's fine. Next one.
Was Kevin Bacon halal?
Get that on a t-shirt.
I don't think so.
I love you. Watch the X-Men First Class. He's halal Hitler.
Next question. What was the first studio film to use profanity?
Wait, where are we on at the moment? I'm very behind here.
Oh, hang on.
Question six.
Yes, six.
Six. Oh, fuck me. What was question five?
Question five was... I have to pick the longest one. The movie includes a titular track from Kenny Loggins. Kevin Bacon performs much of his character's dancing, and John Lithgow leads a charge to band dancing. All of this occurs in what 1984 film?
And number six, if you could, Billy.
Number six. What was the first studio film to use profanity?
What's your profanity? If anyone gets that. No? Great. Cheers.
Yes.
I'm proud of you, Alex. Well done.
Number seven. What was the working title for the 1983 film Star Wars Return of the Jedi?
Something, something, dark side.
Can you repeat that, Billy?
What was the working title for the 1983 film Star Wars Return of the Jedi?
I'm going to be cheating if I have the book like on my bookshelf.
I don't know. Everyone else gets to decide. Is that cheating?
Yes, kick him out.
Yep.
Sick. All right, fuck.
Question 8. Which actor was cast as Marty McFly in Back to the Future before being let go and replaced by Michael J. Fox? Yeah. Question 9. What is the name of the spell used by Ron and Hermione in Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone to make their feathers fly?
I literally just watched all of these recently.
Of course, on Netflix. And the last question, who was the director of the 1996 action thriller The Rock?
Sorry?
Who was the director of the 1996 action thriller The Rock?
Here was me thinking I'd be good at this round. Half done. Fucking horribly.
That's because I've picked like everything pre-1990, or maybe I haven't. Maybe one of the questions isn't pre-1990. But yeah, pre-2000.
I was born in 1998. I thought I'd be all right for this.
Jesus Christ, man. You are old.
Oh, fuck off, Ronan.
Billy, could you repeat number 8, please?
I don't need to find it. Which actor was cast as Marty McFly in Back to the Future before being let go and replaced by Michael J. Fox? Okay, anything else? Anyone?
Can I get free again?
Number 3, which is, according to the Princess Diaries, what fruit is Genovia famous for?
Can I get the last one again? Sorry.
Yep. Who was the director of the 1996 action thriller The Rock?
Billy, can you just repeat all the questions again?
Probably would help, to be honest.
All these old boys losing their hearing, huh? Oh.
I'm losing my hair as well, Ronan. It's not looking good for me.
I can tell. It's not great. It's not a big sexy mullet, is it?
Alex, do you have more subscribers than hairs on your actual head?
Definitely.
Tom, I'm not getting bullied by fucking Tom Atlas. Get in the fridge. Yeah. Fuck off.
That's Tom Atlas.
That's a sponsor for this new video.
Oh, bro, I've done keeps before. I've done literally a hair care product before.
I'm fucking using it then. Because your hairline is going further back.
It doesn't work. I just take the money and
I can wipe my tears with the money. It's fine.
Alex, I can't believe you're getting bullied by Tom Atlas right now.
I was about to say, what's happening here? How the tables have turned.
You'll be all glad to know that I'm not doing a Manscaped ad during this because none of them have went well so far. You're safe from me trying to flog Manscaped. Okay, ready to go through the answers?
Yeah.
Although it's saving me doing an ad, of course, if you go on to manscaped.com and put in the code SWN20, you get 20% off and free shipping. Anywho, right, okay. First question. Jodie Foster sings My Name is Tallulah in which 1976 film?
Got one. Bugsy Malone.
Bugsy Malone, correct.
Yeah, boy.
Oh, I got that wrong.
So, again,
I said Cars. Like,
in 1976.
Yeah.
So again, as we're going by the honor system, just tell me at the end what you got. Cool Runnings tells the story of which country entering a bobsleigh team into the 1988 Winter Olympics in Calgary? Brent?
Jamaica.
Yeah, baby.
Correct. Excellent. Question 3. According to the Princess Diaries, what fruit is Genovia famous for?
I wrote guava, but I don't think that's right.
It's not, Brent.
Pears.
It's pears.
Ah, shit.
I actually thought it was peaches.
I thought peaches.
Yeah.
Peaches.
Question 4. 3 of Jim Carrey's blockbusters, The Mask, Dumb and Dumber, and Ace Ventura, Pet Detective, were all released in what year?
1994.
Yep, 1994. Fantastic year for film. Of course, 4 years old, and the rest of you weren't born, probably.
Hey, I was 4.
Oh, yeah, you forgot your same age.
I still 10 years.
before.
That's how I knew the answer. I had the mask on VHS when I was 4, and I used to scare my neighbor with it because she was like 2 and she was terrified by the face of it. So I used to just get the VHS tape and just like shove it.
Are you sure she wasn't scared of you?
Shut up.
What's sad though that the mask wasn't my first mask film. The only mask film I've ever seen that was my first was that bloody Son of the Mask, and I regret seeing it.
Oh no.
I've managed to avoid ever seeing it.
I regret watching that, but I'm glad I wanted to hear that one.
Question 5. The movie includes a titular track from Kenny Loggins. Kevin Bacon performs much of his character's dancing, and John Lithgow leads a charge to band dancing. All of this occurs in what 1984 film? It was Footloose.
Yeah.
The only reason I know that is from Guardians of the Galaxy. Thank you, Billy.
Yeah.
I should note that before I spoke to Alex fourth time on the podcast, I had a Guardians question that I had to take out, and I also had a Cars question as well that I had to take out. So, sorry, Omar.
How fucking dare you, right?
It was what number is Lightning McQueen?
Oh, come on, easy.
69, dudes.
That was real funny, Glenn. That was real funny.
What was the first studio film to use profanity?
Gone with the Wind.
It was Gone with the Wind?
Yes.
I put Ronan King versus Mickey Vago Summer Hill Showdown 2020.
But I've never heard of it.
I just put in Mirror Max.
I've only just seen that clip now, by the way.
You were literally there.
I know I was, but I wasn't watching.
Yeah, I was, and I didn't hear it.
I only seen it because the person that takes all the really good photos like posted a clip on Twitter. I was like, oh, it was fucking obvious.
It was fucking tremendous, that's what it was.
Fucking amazing.
Right, question 8. Which actor was... No, it's not. Question 7. What was the working title for the 1983 film Star Wars Return of the Jedi? Ben?
Blue Harvest?
It was Blue Harvest.
Damn it.
I only knew that because of Family Guy.
I thought it was From New Hope.
No, apparently it was Return of the Jedi.
I mean, I thought it was Star Wars Electric Boogaloo.
We're all so horribly unfunny.
It's all right. Only one of us in this chat gets paid to be funny. So, we're all right.
Right.
Come on. Question 8. Which actor was cast as Marty McFly in Back to the Future before being let go and replaced by Michael J. Fox? Shout out.
Danny DeVito.
Robert Downey Jr.
It was Eric Stoltz.
Right, I didn't have a name, but I put down the guy who played Rocky Dennis in Mask.
Doesn't count.
No, I know, but is that the guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, cool.
So if you haven't got Eric Stoltz, yeah, haven't got the point. And for my own amusement, just to hear you all shout a spell, what is the name of the spell used by Ron and Hermione in Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone to make their feathers fly?
Bitch.
Yeah,
no, I don't know.
Wingardium Leviosa.
Ballet. Is it Leviosa or Leviosa?
Leviosa.
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 Stop it, Ron.
I just put Leviosa, so that's wrong.
Doesn't care.
That's what I just said. I just said it doesn't count.
Oh my, shut the fuck up.
Did you get it right?
Yeah.
Oh my god, you actually watched the movie.
This year's quiz is a lot more violent.
You've talked multiple times about how good Cars is, Omar.
You enjoyed Cars. You messaged me and said Cars is actually a good movie.
Cars is a peak.
And a good question.
Next year we'll do it live and in person. We'll do it live and in person and end up spouting each other at the end next year. And the final question. Who was director of the 1996 action thriller The Rock?
Michael Bay.
It was Michael Bay.
Oh.
Right, so I've got it here. Brent, how many did you get?
9.
9. Alex?
I got 6.
Shocking. Gaz?
4.
4?
Yeah.
4. Okay. Grant?
8.
Only 8? I thought you were on track to get
4. We can't let him do it again. We can't let him keep getting away with this.
Ronan?
4.
Tom?
1.
Oh, so I'm not the worst here. That's fine.
All right, Tom, you've been fucking taking the piss out of me the entire thing. Do not, I don't want to fucking hear it this time, you dumb stuff.
Omar?
2.
Jesus. Noah?
I thought so bad then.
I thought that was the easiest round that we've got here. So, but I am old. So what is that?
I think you vastly misunderstood the ages in this quiz.
I really have.
One of the movies.
Okay, so I'm doing the tallying. So again, talk amongst yourselves. So I'll do that. It should go better than last time.
Omar, what's the obsession with cars? Genuine intrigue. Why do you like cars so much?
It's my favorite movie of all time, and the world premiere came out on my birthday. So, you know, it's coincidence.
Okay, but why is it your favorite movie, other than it came out on your birthday?
Because I think it is the greatest movie of all time.
Yeah, but why? You can't just say it's the greatest movie and not give a reason.
It's a peak story of Lightning McQueen rising above the hate and persevering and redeeming himself to be selfless in the end. How is
that's
that?
Every movie ever.
That's just every character arc ever.
Yeah.
Yeah, but think about
cars and they're cool. And I don't know, like 5-year-old me loved it. And
it's Owen Wilson as well, so.
Wow.
Wait a minute. So a guy who is the hot shot gets stranded in the desert, meets a group of people, until eventually he learns the true meaning of self-sacrifice.
I'm going to say something really unfunny here, and I hope you realize that before you say it.
You're describing Thor, not cars. Thor and cars
point,
is exactly
point proven.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wasn't trying to be funny, I was just trying to be...
It was a genuine point, Omar, I don't know. Where's the violence coming from here? Fucking hell.
There's a lot of tension in this podcast. A lot of tension for it's supposed to be a nice, delicate quiz.
It goes around his birthday, that's all right.
Billy's birthday? What the fuck are we doing here, boys? Exactly. Come on now.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I mean, you have even my birthday, then, you know.
We've got the video round next. If you want to have an argument and a fight, that's the one to do it for. Okay, so after the second round, we've got Brent in first place with 18. Yep. Okay. Correct me if I'm wrong. Grant in second place with 17. Alex.
Great age.
Alex in third with 12.
Don't know how.
Gaz in fourth with 11. Ronan in fifth with 9. Sixth, Omar with 8. And Tom, bringing up the rear, with 6.
It's happening again, lads. It's happening again, lads.
Billy, are you sure this isn't rigged? Winky face.
I have, again, honor system. That's all I'm going for.
In fairness, Omar, if either me, you, or Ronan win this, it's going to be another Aberdeen Wankathon. We can't be having that.
You can buy your t-shirt now on T-Mail. I mean, if anything, it would only be suspicious because Tom still has access to the website when he was doing Future Shop. So he could have actually checked the answers.
Nah. So,
and he's now, I've seen his face go.
I forgot about that, I can't lie.
He's now, the neurons are firing up.
So we're just going to open up a browser here. And
so next round is Rhys Dawkins, well, perhaps, video round.
Oh, boy.
Why?
Oh, boy, you broke that through man's wrist.
So he will explain the rules.
Deserved.
What's I've shared the screen?
Share your screen.
There it is.
Oh, that guy on the far right.
I can no longer see you guys, so I don't know.
Your eyes.
So I'm going to assume you're okay. So.
Brent's holding the title, but clearly he's looking at how good I am. I mean, come on.
Of course, Nathan North and Nicole Jasmine no longer here. They're still
alive. R.I.P.
R.I.P.
Hey.
Right, so hopefully you'll be able to hear this because Rhys Dawkins will explain the rules in about 5 seconds. So be prepared.
Friends, Romans, countrymen, my name is Rhys Dawkins, and I am the most intelligent professional wrestler on this side of the globe. When I heard that William of the Scottish Wrestling Network was performing some kind of birthday bonanza quiz of some description, I knew that were I to participate, I would defeat every single one of you without breaking a sweat. So, in order to allow you to avoid the embarrassment at my victory, I shall instead be hosting a section of this quiz for you. Since I was told that I'm not allowed to do Shakespeare, instead I shall be reading you a paragraph about professional wrestling history. However, there will be an error within that paragraph. If you can correctly identify where the mistake is, that is 1 point. If you are able to also tell me what the correct answer is, that's an additional point. The 10 points in all, 5 questions altogether. So, let's begin, shall we?
I didn't watch that beforehand, so I thought it was 5 points on offer, so shite. Okay.
Oh, God, so, okay.
He's gone, thank God.
So again, yeah, if you get 2 points, just tell me. So we're going to do 1 question at a time, because I was stupid when I was putting this question set together. We're going to get question, then answer. So first one will come up in 5 seconds. 3, 2, 1.
The Elimination Chamber is a brutal stipulation. Metal chains and grating make it an imposing structure, and many titles have changed hands within it. In 2003, for example, Triple H defended the World Heavyweight Championship against Goldberg, Randy Orton, Kevin Nash, Chris Jericho, and Shawn Michaels. Goldberg tore through the competition and walked away with the gold, allowing Triple H to recover from a groin injury he suffered before the match.
Okay, so that was the statement. Everyone hear it?
Yeah.
Okay, so...
I'd like to point out one more time, I wasn't born for this, so this isn't fair.
You got the question about, like, something footloose, I can't remember. You got one right that was before you.
You got the Gone with the Wind question.
Yeah, exactly. There we go.
Really, can you play that real quick?
Replay it. Give me a second.
Yeah, please.
Okay. Play.
The Elimination Chamber is a brutal stipulation. Metal chains and grating make it an imposing structure, and many titles have changed hands within it. In 2003, for example, Triple H defended the World Heavyweight Championship against Goldberg, Randy Orton, Kevin Nash, Chris Jericho, and Shawn Michaels. Goldberg tore through the competition and walked away with the gold, allowing Triple H to recover from a groin injury he suffered before the match.
Okay, everyone get the header?
Yeah.
I think so.
Right. Who wants to shout out? Like I said, I can't see you, so I just have to shout out.
The error was that Goldberg won. He didn't. Shawn Michaels did.
No, he didn't. Triple H.
No, that's fine. Yeah, Triple H won it.
Yeah.
Triple H won it. Shawn Michaels won
in
2002.
Okay.
Goldberg didn't win, but Triple H did have a groin injury. He just wore compression shorts throughout it.
Yes.
Okay, so all happy to go for the answer then. You're
Yep.
Yeah, okay. So, 5 seconds.
The groin injury is true, but Triple H actually retained the championship at this event, losing it to Goldberg a month later at Unforgiven.
There you go. That's the first one. We've got 4 more of these. So
just to get this right, I just wrote Triple H won. That was the thing that was wrong. But is that 2 points or is that like?
See, I would say, it's 2 points.
The thing that was wrong was that Goldberg won, but the thing that's like it was actually Triple H. So
yeah, so that's 2 points. Yeah, okay, cool.
That's 2 points.
I think as well, I've got 1 point.
Yeah,
I think if you can tell something's wrong, then that's a point. But if you can correct him, it's like, I know for a fact that Great Khali didn't win the 2007 Royal Rumble, but I couldn't tell you who won it. So that'd just be 1 point if you can tell me who won it.
Yeah,
Undertaker, then you get 2 points.
Mm-hmm.
So, does that
mean am I right,
Billy?
Yeah, that sounds right. Yeah, so Goldberg didn't win the title. That's 1 point. Triple H won the title. That's the 2nd point. Yes. Okay. Right. 2nd question. In a moment.
Not everyone can become a world champion, even in WWE when they can have as many as 3 at a time. Not everyone can hold the most prestigious prize. Though some renowned grapplers like Mr. Perfect, Ricky Steamboat, and Shelton Benjamin have become synonymous with the secondary Intercontinental Championship, with Mr. Perfect in particular holding the current record for the longest individual title reign with the belt.
Okay, so it's your second one. So, anyone want to throw out the correction?
Yeah, Mr. Perfect wasn't the longest holding champion, if I'm correct in that.
No, right? Honky Tonk Man.
It's Honky Tonk Man, yeah.
Incorrect, it's Gunther.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Not yet.
Gunther's reached a year, right enough, but it's the Honky Tonk.
As of recording, yep, that's it. Mr. Perfect doesn't hold the longest reign. The Honky Tonk Man does. Such a.
Although Gunther, does Gunther not overtake it?
He's held it for one year now. He's close to overtaking it, but not quite at the moment.
So the podcast will be like out of date in about a month, 2 months time, or something like that. Which is actually better, because sometimes I have podcasts that are out of date like the day before I put them out. So yes, it's improvement. Okay, question three. Or statement three.
I mean, we've got the answer, don't we?
Oh, yeah, Mr. Perfect doesn't hold the longest reign. Honky Tonk Man does. Okay, right.
This prestigious honor of the longest single individual title reign of the Intercontinental Championship is not held by Mr. Perfect as of this recording, nor is it held by Ricky Steamboat or Shelton Benjamin. It is held by the Honky Tonk Man at around 454 days. The shortest reign is Dean Douglas with less than a day.
Right, shut up. I forgot that we had the answer section as well. Okay.
He says as of this recording, it's not Mr. Perfect. Like, Mr. Perfect could break the record, even though he's dead.
You don't know.
Mr. Perfect 2.
What's really annoying me with these videos is, well, actually two things. One, Reese Dawkins is doing it. And two, he's like fading out right still as he's talking.
Oh, that's my fault. The fading out is my fault, in fairness.
Okay, what's going on there, Billy? Come on.
Come on, man.
If you've watched these videos, you know how shit I am editing. Just question three.
Many people dislike the two rivals who can't get along become tag team champions trope, but I find it incredibly entertaining. MVP and Matt Hardy's segments of one-upsmanship, Eddie Guerrero and Tajiri's cultural clash, and Cesaro and Sheamus with the conclusion to their best of seven series all led to very entertaining moments and championship victory.
It's my birthday, guys, and I'm starting to get annoyed in this quiz, so, you know, this has been good fun. Anyway, right, okay. So, statement three. Where's the error? What's the error?
Eddie and Tajiri weren't rivals turned partners. Yeah. Tajiri stepped in for Chavo's injury, and then they fought.
Okay, everyone happy with that?
Cool. Yeah.
2003's finest.
Yeah.
Okay.
I got the point for saying Eddie Guerrero and Tajiri were, I guess, tag team champions.
Yeah.
Is that the point? Yeah.
The actual cultural differences were Tajiri and Regal, not Tajiri and Guerrero.
Yeah.
So is that the point there, or is it?
Who knows?
Well, we'll let Reese tell you what the point is in a second or two.
Reese has fucked the system with this quiz.
Tajiri were not rivals.
I think partners,
though they were champions together. Chavo Guerrero was injured during a feud with the world's greatest tag team, and so Tajiri won the belt with Eddie Guerrero as a replacement.
So,
yeah.
So, yeah, they weren't rivals when they were champions, and they became rivals afterwards. So, I think that's your 2 points there.
Okay, so I got 0 points then.
Okay. number four. Sorry, there's two more, and then we've got Ian Skinner's round. So.
Can we just stay here? We'll just keep doing these questions over on repeat.
Good luck, everyone.
In 1996, Rowdy Roddy Piper and WCW heavyweight champion Hulk Hogan battled for the main event of Starrcade. After avoiding the shenanigans of the NWO, dressing them down in promos, and being brutally attacked after hip replacement surgery, Piper wrote up the contract and was able to defeat Hogan with the sleeper hold, a rare submission loss that saw Piper walk away with the WCW Championship.
No, this round is going better than I thought it would.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Dawkins is a talented man.
Do you want an answer?
Yeah, I thought the answer. What do you think it is?
It was a non-title match. So Roddy Piper won, but he didn't win the title.
Okay, is that everyone happy with that? We'll just move on to the answer.
Yep.
Okay.
Roddy Piper did not win the championship, though he did win the match. Despite writing up the contract himself, it appears the Hot Rod forgot to add that little stipulation.
So yeah,
if I said Roddy Piper wasn't WCW champion, does that count for a point?
I would say so, because he didn't win the title. So yeah, I would say.
I wrote Piper didn't win the title, Hogan retained, but I wrote that thinking Piper lost. So I feel like I'm pretty much a no point here.
Yeah, you knew where the error was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll get that.
I didn't know it was a match, but I know for a fact Piper never won the title in 96, so I wrote that.
I'll give myself 1 point. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that sounds fair. Okay, so we've got the last one. Just one more.
The Grand Slam in wrestling is an honor granted to very few, and is incredibly difficult to gauge as many companies handle them differently. WWE have two male variations, with the likes of Shawn Michaels and John Cena as members, as well as a more recent women's variant. TNA had a standard version with holders such as AJ Styles and Samoa Joe, who won the tag team championships by himself. Ring of Honor's six-man tag team championship was considered and had holders such as Matt Taven, and New Japan's Grand Slam was established in 2021 with the distinction of including only singles championships.
Yeah, so that's the last one there. Nice little one. So, any ideas?
John Cena isn't a Grand Slam champion because he needs the Intercontinental Championship.
Yeah, and okay, that's fine. I think that's everyone happy with that. Move on to the answer.
John Cena has never held the Intercontinental Championship, and therefore is not considered to be a Grand Slam champion by any of WWE's established metrics.
There we go. So yeah, I think your 2 points there is John Cena not a Grand Slam champion, and the second point is he needs the Intercontinental Championship. Okay, we're all good. So yep. He does have an outro that I will play, and then. I had a blooper, which as well, but I haven't. He asked not to put it in this bit, so, I could show you later if you really want to. But anyway, right, outro, and then we can see your lovely faces again.
I hope you enjoyed my little segment all about the historical recall of professional wrestling and its championships. If you managed to get some of these correct, congratulations. And if you didn't, I'm not surprised. But the next time Billy has one of these quizzes, be sure to keep in mind the great works of William Shakespeare will grant you the intelligence necessary, potentially, to walk away with the victory. Unless, of course, I happen to be participating. Mark my words.
There we go. That was round... God, I've kind of lost the will a little bit. Three. Round three.
Part of my soul just died during that round just because it was Reese Dawkins.
Omar, you broke the poor man's wrist.
I was about to say, Omar, you've done enough damage to the poor boy.
It was his fault.
And after all that, Brent, how many points did you get in that round?
10.
10.
Oh, fuck off.
Alex?
7.
Gaz?
4.
4. That seems to be your calling card at this point.
I can't do the math because I've only got Triple H, one Honky Tonk Man, non-title match, and Cena isn't a Grand Slam. So
I would say that's okay. We'll go for Grant.
9. 9. 6.
Grant, you're literally the only hope we have of winning here. Come on,
Rodan.
It's all of us versus Brent.
I got 7. Gaz, which one at 4?
4. Tom.
4.
And Omar.
4.
Bunch of losers. Right, okay.
Ouch. Ouch.
I'm going to do the subs. So give me a moment and I'll do that. Yeah, I can do this. I'm an intelligent man.
So this is fun.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We have to fill in the dead air now. Yeah, Grant, you're our only hope. Go on now. I'll get behind you. Well, come on.
Okay, so I like this new system. I'm going to keep that going for next year. With just you telling me the scores at the end. At the moment, in first place is the champion, Brent Carter, with 28 points. Second place, Grant McIvor, with 26. So it's still all to play for. Somehow in third place is Alex Webb, with 19. Fourth place is Gaz Williams, with 15. Yep. Next is Ronan, with 13. Omar, with 12. And then Tom, again, just hugging that rear, with 10.
Yeah. Still here.
Oh, okay. I've counted wrong. I thought I had 10. Thank you for reminding me that I have 12.
That's because you got two in the last round. So,
yeah.
Okay. This is the worst round that we have next. I've called it Ian Skinner's Almost a Submarine Round because it's long and hard, but it doesn't have any semen. We've got 10 terrible questions, loads of additional points, and I have trusted that he has fact-checked all of them.
Fair choice.
He's not, but, you know, we'll go with it.
So this could be the difference maker. If you know Japanese wrestling, this could be the one for you. So,
shit.
Good luck, guys. Okay. Just everyone just take a minute. Does anyone need to take a break before we do this round? Anyone need to...
feel like it's probably good we take a break before we have to deal with fucking Skinner's pish.
Yeah, can I? So, I need to use the bathroom.
We're going to take a wee bathroom break then, and we're going to come back.
I'll be 2 seconds.
Okay, right. Either fill the dead air, or I will just do the old SpongeBob 2 seconds later thing.
Oh, God.
Follow at Ronan_King_ on TikTok, Twitter, Instagram, everything. Thanks.
I think I do already. I'll just double check.
You should.
I'm sure I do.
Why am I here?
I don't know, because you hate me, so you want to try and win my title, probably. Oh, yeah, no. I've got you.
I don't want to be around anymore.
Like, the quiz, or in general? Are you okay?
Too much shit on me.
Oh, man, I really hope Billy cuts this out, otherwise this is going to be really sad.
There's too much shit on me, I can't breathe.
I've returned. Oh, well, I can't wait to curb stomp you on Saturday.
What's happening Saturday?
You're getting fucked over is what's happening.
Are we talking wrestling or are we talking anything else here?
Both.
I feel like you're insinuating something that I'm not old comfortable.
Old Malcolm.
I quite literally walked in on. Tom, tidy your room. Yeah. I'm in the middle of getting something organized, so no.
So how's it going so far? That's what, 3 rounds?
Yeah, you missed Omar have a sort of existential crisis. It was
it's
concerning.
I don't want to be around anymore.
Bro, do you need to talk? Yeah, it took me a while to understand what he was doing.
There's too much shit on me. I can't breathe. What's the show? Oh, God damn it.
I haven't even showed off the trophy yet on the episode, which, you know, it's a shame. I'll lots of people will come back.
Sorry, it can go with the rest of them.
We'll do a montage of me holding at the end when I win it.
If by some miracle you win, I will personally drive to your house and hand it to you.
Good.
Bit weird, but...
I have...
So I don't know if that's a threat or a promise.
As long as Brent doesn't do another one of those nude photo shoots, I'm happy with anyone else.
God.
No. Mistakes were made.
Yeah.
Yeah. To be fair, I said it as a joke, and then I wasn't going to do it, and then Brody was like, "Where is it? We're waiting." And I was like, "Oh, for fuck's sake, okay."
So Blaine Brody.
You can say no, Brent. You can say
You have met me. I cannot say no. I have like some sort of overwhelming urge to try and please everyone because I have many mental health issues. I cannot say no.
I'm with that.
Let me
I just what okay.
What? Round four.
You took a real left turn there, but sure.
That's why I'm on these. Come on, I'm.
No drug use on this podcast, right? Okay, so we're back. Round four, the penultimate round of the podcast, and I haven't actually shown off the prize yet. The winner of this episode will not only either retrieve or keep the Day of Birth Bonanza Championship, which has also not appeared on the screen yet.
Oh, it's up here.
There it is, right in the background.
Along with the trophy for the second Day of Birth, like, you know.
That was possibly, I mean, I like this trophy because it actually looks some sort of professionalism.
Wait, no, you can't be this. Hang on.
But I love that trophy from last year. Just because it was so bad that the stickers that came with it had
nothing
had
beats
typos.
The you're awesome without an E, number one.
That's quite wonderful. Also, our people that's got trophies in this particular episode, of course, Ronan King has a one to watch. Alex Webb in the background, he has two for podcast of the year and tag team of the one to watch tag team. That's it. So
what plan?
So I got nothing.
And the winner will receive this beautiful piece of hardware.
Very pretty.
Yeah, you see that, Judas Grey? You see that fucking Judas Grey? One to watch, motherfucker, not you.
Sorry, I had to get that out of my system.
That running as well, dipshit. Sorry, that was me.
So I have a box ready. I have some bubble wrap and everything that I haven't popped. This will be going your way at some point before.
I'm just saying, it's going to look very nice next to the plot, even though I'm in
no
for...
No one cares! Sorry.
Tom,
do you have have you not taken your fucking medication today? What's up with this? What were you doing?
No.
Ian Skinner is almost a submarine round next.
Jesus Christ. Okay.
So, first question is for 2 points. Which two graduated of the LA... I should have checked these. Just copied and pasted.
LA Dojo, do you mean?
Which two graduated of the LA Dojo... LA Dojo made their debuts on Ian Skinner's birthday. So which two graduates? That's it. There's a D there. It should be. Which two graduates of the LA Dojo made their debuts on Ian Skinner's birthday for 2 points? I like that it's my birthday bash, but sorry, Bonanza. Sorry, Bagel. Bonanza.
But it says when he says debut. When he says debut, does he mean New Japan Pro Wrestling debut, strong debut, general debut? What does he mean there? Do we know?
Up, Tom. No, I don't know. I don't know.
Tom, you're thinking way too much into this.
You got to get in the mind of Ian Skinner.
Fuck that.
Okay, ready to move on? Question two?
I'm changing the answer. Tom.
Guess? I don't know.
No, I've only got one name that's I can't even think of the other.
So that's 1 point, maybe, if you got it right.
I'm happy to take 1 point.
Which London tube station refers to... No, sorry. Which London tube station relates to Michael Oku? Again, I've trusted Ian Skinner has done the research and the fact.
What does that mean, though? Like, what London Street relates to a specific wrestler? Is like...
Again, all questions could be
I mean, there's no tube station called the OGMO. Like, that's the only thing I can think of.
Is there one in the half crap?
I have the answer, so I will reveal in the answers how it relates to him. Okay.
Maybe like wrote it once.
I'm just gonna. I don't know.
Question three: Ace Payne is a wrestler now known as. So we got a tube bar. Did you do there?
The road next to my house is on a like motorbike trail.
Ah.
It's motorbikes.
That's fine. I just heard it like it was very, it was like Law and Order. It was quite dramatic that I read it and it just
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Cool. Question four. How many times did Jonathan Gresham defend the Ring of Honor world title in AEW? There's a bonus 2 points if you name the opponents. So 1 point.
In AEW or like the person that he lost it to?
In AEW.
Wait, repeat the question, please.
Okay. How many times did Jonathan Gresham defend the Ring of Honor world title in AEW? And there's a bonus 2 points if you name both opponents.
Don't mention it. I already know what you're thinking. Don't mention it.
Okay, question five. I've got to read the answers to this one. I'm not looking forward to it. Name the four young boys of the four pillars. That's 4 points on offer.
So name four young boys of the four
pillars. Yeah. Each of the four pillars has a young boy. Oh God, this is just
anyone that doesn't understand is going to
is this
be very questioning this.
Is this AEW or
no? So it's all like the Japanese. Four pillars. The four pillars of like Japanese wrestling. So if you think like who's like the biggest fucking names you can think of in like Japanese wrestling?
I feel like I can make 8 points if you can name the four pillars as well.
Oh, my fuck. No, because, like, okay.
Four pillars are young boys. All right, well.
Yeah, that's what we're going to do. 8 points on offer in this one. If four young boys, the four pillars. So if you name the four young boys and the four pillars, you get a total of 8 points. So that's a big one. That could be the difference maker.
Okay.
And I apologize in advance for me reading out the names. As you can tell, English is barely my first language. Okay, next question. Number six. Which two wrestlers inspired Tajiri? 2 points on offer.
Just inspired.
Inspired. I assume he put it in his book.
Is it a point per wrestler?
Point per wrestler, yeah.
This is like a huge point round. Like, Jesus Christ!
I know. Yeah. I mean, this is one, Alex. If you know your Japanese wrestling, that could be joining.
I'm all right with Japanese wrestling. I feel quite confident in this right now.
Question about question five: is it a point per young boy and a point?
Yeah, per yeah, pillar? 8 points in total. So if you only get three young boys, that's 3 points. If you get all eight, then that's 8 points. And again, trusting you guys to keep track on it because my brain's kind of fried just thinking about that question. If any consolation, when he sent me these questions, I didn't get any of them. I had to go. I assumed he's right. Okay, so because I don't watch Japanese wrestling. Next question: name the tag team who were in opposite corners of each other for Tajiri's WWF TV debut.
What even is that question?
It took me a while to understand it. So name the tag team who were in opposite corners of each other for Tajiri's WWF TV debut. He was in a match, and in each corner, it was a tag team match, and a well-known tag team were on opposite sides of the ring. Just name the tag team.
Can I ask what year this was?
No.
Fuck.
I mean, you could ask.
I realize I'm not going to get an answer here.
Okay.
Okay.
Right, question eight. Who was Kenta's opponent in his last match in WWE?
Oh.
And for those of the pedantic people that are listening at home, who was Hideo Itami's opponent in his last match in WWE?
Oh, this is a fucking guess.
Yeah, we've got another 2-pointer for question nine, which is who wrestled to be part of the WWE Cruiserweight Classic but did not qualify? So again, point for each.
Oh, because like Progress did like videos on YouTube for the qualifiers, didn't they?
Yeah.
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 So what question are we on right now? Because I feel like I've missed like a bunch of them.
Nine.
Okay, so...
Who else?
I am so lost.
So, who wrestled to qualify and didn't make it?
Yeah, so there's a couple of qualifiers. Like say Progress. Wasn't there one somewhere else? I can't remember where though. And
Rev Pro.
That sounds right, Rev Pro. So they wrestled to be part of the Cruiserweight Classic, but didn't qualify for it. So.
And these are the guys that lost. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I remember one because I remember watching one of them because Sabre was the other person in the match.
And the final one, which I feel like I'm going to have a bit of explanation with following up. Who did Drew McIntyre's NXT return entrance theme originally belong to?
Okay, yeah.
Aha!
That's number 10.
That's number 10.
That's fine.
Right. Any entrance theme? Drew McIntyre's.
No.
Any you need to read out again?
Three,
which is Ace Payne is a wrestler now known as... ..
Could you repeat 7 and 8?
Okay. 7, name the tag team who were in opposite corners of each other for Tajiri's WWF TV debut. Yep. And 8 is, who was Kenta's opponent in his last match in WWE?
No, I need to change that one.
Okay. Any more needs to be read out? Quite happy just to start going through the answers.
Only 2 seconds, not on another answer.
What was number 9? Sorry.
Number 9 was who wrestled to be part of the WWE Cruiserweight Classic but did not qualify. So I think this is gonna be the big round. This is gonna be the difference maker. We might see some movement in the scores.
What was question 1? Because I look like I've started to write the answer and then stopped. Yeah.
Which 2 graduates of LA Dojo made their debuts on Ian Skinner's birthday for 2 points?
I genuinely think I've got one of these. I don't even know if it's his birthday, but I know Skinner likes this particular wrestler, so I'm just going with that.
Okay.
Which birthday?
Was it like the Queen? He's got 2.
Now, which one of his birthdays? How old was he?
I don't know. He didn't write that.
When's your birthday? Every year.
Every year.
Get out.
Okay, we'll go through the answers then. First question, which 2 graduates of LA Dojo made their debuts on Ian Skinner's birthday for 2 points? Yeah, Alex?
Is it Alex? I can't pronounce his second name, but it's like Colin or something like that.
I'm guessing it's Coughlin.
He fucking tweets about him, yeah.
Alex Coughlin and anyone else want to throw in their one?
Gabriel Kidd.
Tom, do you want to go for it?
Shooter. Shooter Umino.
It's Clark Connors.
Yes!
Okay. I got
Coughlin.
I put Clark Connors, but I also had Kevin Knight, and that was the only 2 that I could think of.
There you go. Clark Connors, Alec Coughlin. Well done to anyone who's got
Alex
those.
Alex Coughlin's a fucking beast.
He's fucking awesome.
Like, aye, in a good way, not in the June 2020 way. Right, okay. for a podcast that promotes positivity, I make an awful lot of speaking out jokes. Right, okay, so next question. Which London
you don't laugh, you cry.
Exactly. Yeah, that's I'm sure that's what they tell them. Which London Tube station?
Oh, Billy.
Oh no.
We might need to do the whole
there's a storm again. Brewing. There's a storm brewing.
And take 2.
Now we know all the answers.
Hold on.
Which London tube station relates to Michael Oku?
I took a fucking guess, but I think might be right. Is it Old Street?
It's Old Street.
Damn.
He is billed from Old Street, London. Apparently. There you go. Question 3. Ace Payne is a wrestler now known as
Will Ospreay.
Osprey.
It's Ospreay. Yep.
didn't get
that. Fuck's sake, I'm a fan of Will Ospreay. I didn't fucking know.
Will Ospreay. I did not.
I'm pretty Johnny Ace.
So
for potential 3 points, how many times did Jonathan Gresham defend the Ring of Honor world title in AEW? God, give it to Tom. Tom.
2 times.
Correct, 2 times is the answer.
Jericho and Bandido.
Incorrect. It is anyone else?
Dalton Castle and Lee Moriarty.
Correct. There we go. Yeah. Dalton Castle and Lee Moriarty.
Do we get 3 points for that?
You get 3 points if you got all them. You get, if you've only got one of them, you get, oh. Yeah, so
point did for each. Did he not defend it against Samoa Joe? Is that who he lost it to?
Yeah, that was on Ring of Honor.
They lost it to Cesaro on AEW TV.
Well, I thought he faced Samoa Joe.
No, it was Ring of Honor.
Death before honor.
Okay, so the worst question for my brain and everyone's maths. Name the four young boys of the four pillars. And name the four pillars. Go,
I can name the pillars.
Yeah.
And I can name a couple of young boys, but I don't know how right I am with this.
Right, okay. Name the pillars.
The pillars are Kobashi, Misawa, Kawada, and Teu.
Thank God you said it, because I didn't know how to pronounce that last one. So
I don't know how to pronounce it either. I know it's they're big in the Wrestling Empire game, so I kind of got it off of that.
Yeah. So that's the four pillars. Who wants to take a crack at the young boys? Yeah, you know what I mean.
LA, come on.
I mean, is Shibata one?
Pass this, Billy.
Shibata's not one.
No? Suzuki.
Is one Kenta?
That's Kenta.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I've got Kenta, Marufuji, Tachi.
Yeah.
And Morishima.
I didn't get him.
I just got Kenta, you know.
Right, that's a point there. Okay.
1 point. Sure.
So I think I've got all the jokes out of my system about, you know, that time. So I think we'll be okay for the remaining of the podcast.
Well, Billy, when it rains, it pours.
Exactly. Which two wrestlers inspired Tajiri for 2 points?
Suzuki?
Nope. Tom?
Ultimate Dragon and Great Muta?
Correct. Ultimate Dragon and Great Muta.
Is that a point per? Yeah.
Yep. 2 points total. Point.
I'll take Great Muta.
That's right.
Go. Next one. Name the tag team who were in opposite corners of each other for Tajiri's WWF TV debut. Brent?
I'm guessing here, but Taka Michinoku and Funaki?
Wrong. Anyone else want to throw in?
The Guerreros?
Oh.
Yeah, Tom?
The Guerreros?
Nope. All right, go for it.
Is it too cool?
It's too cool. Or at the time, too much. It's Scott Taylor and Brian Christopher was the opposite corners. It was on Shotgun Saturday Night. For those there, curious. And question 8: who was Kenta's opponent in his last match in WWE?
Tozawa.
It was Tozawa. Yeah. Yep.
I thought it was Tozawa.
Did he turn heel after his match with Bobby Roode?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All I know is turning heel on 205
Live for a bit.
Yeah, turn heel and then targeting Aleister Black.
So, penultimate question of the round, which I think I've built this up because I don't know any of the answers, but it seems like you guys are doing pretty well in this particular round. Who wrestled to be part of the WWE Cruiserweight Classic but did not qualify for 2 points, Brent?
Right. So. I know that Zack Sabre Jr. fought Flash Morgan Webster.
Yep.
And I think Noam Dar fought Josh Bodum.
No.
So you got Flash Morgan Webster. Tom?
It's Pete.
Is it Chris Ridgway?
It's Pete Dunne.
It's Pete Dunne.
Oh,
God. 2 points.
2 points.
I'll take Flash, though. That was a stab in the dark.
Okay, and the last question of the round is, who did Drew McIntyre's NXT return entrance theme originally belong to? Gaz?
Roderick Strong.
Yeah. Roderick Strong, yep.
Because I remember that was his debut match in for the Dusty Road Tag Team Classics in 2016.
I had to go check.
He teamed up with someone who used to be in NXT, but I'm not going to mention his name. But I remember Drew had the theme song, but it was changed with, but it started with the bagpipes and then added to that.
So there was a possible, I'm reckoning, 21 points on offer in this round. So quite a big one. Brent, how many did you get?
11.
Okay. Alex.
20.
20. Wow.
Whoa.
Oh, shit. Oh. About,
again, where is it?
Gaz.
2.
2.
Yeah.
Okay. Grant.
12.
12. Okay. Ronan.
14, baby.
14. Wow. Yeah. Tom.
4.
4. Add Omar.
6.
6. Right, I'll go back and do the sums. So you guys are filling in the dead air again.
Why do we let Strachan? I just want to Google something really quick.
I really just went off Wrestling Empire for that, and a lot of yeah.
Time to re-download it.
Fair play.
It's because I did a video on it like earlier on, so I had quite a lot of like fucking Japanese wrestlers in my head.
I was right. Okay. Billy.
Yo.
Noam Dar did fight Josh Bodum to qualify for the Cruiserweight Classic. That was a match that happened.
Oh, okay.
What?
Ooh.
So there was 3?
So there was 3. Okay. Controversial.
So,
I don't know what to do. Do I give you an extra point for that?
Give him the extra point. It's technically called it right.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
It's a match that, so 12.
Okay. You may regret that in a moment,
yeah.
Alex. Okay, so...
If I'm being facetious, Blue Harvest was a new hope, not return.
See, I believe...
No, it was the working title for Return of the Jedi, but it was the title that Family Guy used for their version of...
Because it was working title for A New Hope.
We can just go off what Skinner said for the answers. So it's up to you.
Right. Okay. So the consensus was that Brent gets an extra point. If it is a 1 point difference, we will go back to that question about Return of the Jedi, and we'll take it from there. Okay. So we're okay with that. Okay. In first place at the moment is Brent Carter with 40 points. In second place is Alex Webb. With
39.
Oh! Over. Fucked it.
God damn.
Well done.
Grant McIvor next with 38. Ronan with 27. Which is a pretty good catch up. Omar with 18. Gaz with 17. And Tom, as always, 14.
You know what? I'll say that.
We're into the final round. You'll all be glad to hear. I didn't think of a funny title for this. It's just called General Knowledge. I got really tired after, you know, the other rounds. And there we go. Okay, so this is nice, simple general knowledge. We've got three possible winners all to play for. Like I said, we may have some controversy. Go back up to one question if we need to. I have not prepared a tiebreaker. So...
Yeah.
I hope that one of you win outright. Okay, general knowledge, final round. Which country won the first FIFA World Cup in 1930? Okay.
What? Do you have 10 questions in this round?
I have 10 questions in this round, yes.
Well, thank you.
So there's no bonus points. It's 10 points on offer, all to play for, except for the bottom half of the board. But, you know. So which country won the first FIFA World Cup in 1930? Question 2. What's the name of the Coco Pops mascot?
Coco Pops.
Is it the monk? Is it the monkey one or the bird one in the US?
I'm assuming the monkey.
Yeah, sure.
I'm assuming.
I will not. It's the Coolpox mascot. I didn't know there was a new one. If there was. Question three: which famous novel features the character Atticus Finch? Well, this is a nice, like, delicate, cool round at the end after Ian Skinner's one.
What was the question again? Sorry.
Which famous novel features the character Atticus Finch?
I'm looking at it now.
Of course you would get it, Grant.
I mean, technically, didn't we say that Alex can do that with one of the other ones, where he can look at what was on the shelf?
Unfortunately, Alex said out loud...
Well, I can't look inside the fucking book from here.
Oh, we actually need the book, to be honest. We're going back to that
I'm having a blast.
Question four. What is the capital of Hungary? It's not H, for anyone that's thinking it.
What was number three again, sorry?
Which famous novel features...
Finch.
Yeah, Finch. Hi.
Yeah.
Question four. What's the capital of Hungary? Question five: what is the national animal of Scotland? Yeah, question seven. No,
six.
Yes.
Next year I'm adding an extra column with the numbers. Which country won 2023's Eurovision Song Contest?
Oh God.
You guys are trusting me to count at the end, and I can't even count how many questions we've done. So that's...
Can you repeat that?
Which country won 2023's Eurovision Song Contest?
That's a fucking banger, by the way. The song is...
All I'm saying is three of us were wrestling in Arunaniki that night, so I don't think you can expect us to get this right, so it's biased.
I mean, no. My girlfriend was messaging me the entire time.
I was at the show.
Different team.
I mean, if Alex is saying it's a banger, then he's got it wrong.
No, I'm gonna throw in some bonus points in this one. If he can name the artist and title of the song, I'll give you two extra points.
Oh no!
Oh boy! I've heard the song. I can't remember where it's from. I mean, the cha 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 should have won.
Correct, but yeah. You know. Okay, so just typing it so I remember that I'm giving you two extra points if you get that right. There you go. Next question. What is the world's largest carnivorous marsupial? Nothing like adding long words that I could barely say into a quiz.
That's a long one.
What a guess, Tom. Well done.
Someone's tweets have been checked. Right, next.
Whoa, one of those. I deleted the bird app, I'm okay.
Next question. What is the square root of 256?
Wait, what?
That was question eight. What is the square root of 256?
I've gotten that for maths. This is unfair.
I can't do math.
Tom, out of everything you've said in this entire quiz, I believe that statement the most.
Correct.
Yeah.
Question nine. Which planet is the home to the Doctor?
Is this a Doctor Who thing?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's not just someone from Casualty, Ronan.
And the last question of this quiz, hopefully, otherwise I'm going to find a tiebreaker. What is the currency of Vietnam?
Yeah.
Nice grown up one for the last question there. Right.
Is this because the currency just sounds valid?
Thomas Mumford has got a few of these.
Oh no.
I don't actually know the currency.
Yeah, he's sitting there blank, he doesn't know.
Any need any red out?
Again?
We all right.
No, good.
No, okay. On right. Let's do this. The final round. There's three. I mean, unless everyone no, there's three possible winners here. So it's all quite exciting. Which country won the first FIFA World Cup in 1930? Brent?
Uruguay.
It's Uruguay. Yes.
Oh,
look at this.
I had that and I changed it.
Question two. What's the name of the Coco Pops mascot? Anyone? Brent?
Coco.
Is it just Coco?
Coco.
Yeah. Coco the monkey. So you get a point for Coco.
So amazing.
Coco. I'm so bad.
I like to throw that one as a little wee trick question. I wanted to just go, can't be Coco. It'll be Snap. Which famous novel features the character Atticus Finch?
That one Grant's got.
Oh, great. Thank you for the audio listeners here. Which book is it?
To Kill a Mockingbird.
Thank you.
Oh, never
mind. It's the silence of everyone listening to this going, what's the answer? So, yeah, To Kill a Mockingbird. What's the capital of Hungary?
Budapest.
Yay. Oh, answer right, Jesus Christ.
Budapest.
next up, what is the national animal of Scotland?
Unicorn.
Tom. Unicorn.
Yes, Tom, it's a unicorn.
Oh, fuck, I got it.
The a unicorn is not even a fucking animal, but fair enough.
How do you know? It could have been.
I mean, yeah, fair enough.
Realistically, what's more realistic, unicorns or giraffes? Like, giraffes are...
There, that's your pondering for when this podcast ends. If you've learned anything at all, are giraffes real? Which country won 2023's Eurovision Song Contest? Bonus 2 points for title and artist.
It was Sweden, and it was by Loreen Tattoo.
There you go. That's your 3 points if you got all of them. If you got just the title, just the artist, 1 point for...
Damn it.
Shit.
But you're right, though. Finland's cha-cha-cha should have won.
Yeah, it's a conspiracy.
Yeah, bloody ABBA. Next, what is the world's largest carnivorous marsupial? Brent?
It threw me off with carnivorous.
It's a Tasmanian devil.
It's a Tasmanian devil.
Shit.
I thought you just spun around in circles a lot.
I mean, it was very big doing it. And question eight, what is the square root of 256? Tom.
Fuck it, 13.
No!
No!
It's 16.
It's 16.
Oh, shit.
Wasn't too far off.
I thought too high.
I thought it was 4.
I thought it was 349 for a reason.
I don't think you know what a square root is.
No, I can't do that.
Although I am joined this round that Omar looks absolutely lost and fed up.
Honestly, yeah. Every answer, I'm so confident. I'm like, wait, no, I'm not. I've got it wrong.
Is this one of those times where you think I shouldn't have sent that DM going, oh, we'll do it?
I mean, it was Ronan that said that if I was going to go on, then he'd go on. So, you know, it's kind of him.
Don't back out of it now.
I knew I could beat Omar no matter what, so I asked him to do it with me, so there's nothing bad that happened to me.
We've got two questions left. Which planet is a home? No, it's not. Which planet is home to the Doctor?
Gallifrey.
Yeah, and I feel like this one we should all shout out together. What is the currency of Vietnam?
Dong.
There we go. That's all the questions of this incredible day of birth bonanza asked and answered. Like I say, I may need a moment to look for a tiebreaker if required, but until then,
my head hurts.
How many points did you get, Brent?
12.
12. Alex?
11.
Oh, Grant.
12.
Gaz.
Two.
Ronan.
Five.
Tom.
Three.
And Omar.
One.
One.
Beautiful.
I think we know that how this is going to go for those that are keeping track.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
But I will still do the sums just to make sure. Again, talk amongst yourselves while I'm doing it.
No, I don't want to. I'm fucking pissed.
I don't want to.
Just gonna.
I feel you just.
And last one, 18 plus one. Dear. Okay. I'll go in ascending order. Yeah, last first. In last place is Titanium Tom Atlas with 17 points.
Wait, I'm not last. Oh my god.
Next up, joint, whatever number's next, it's Umar Mohammed and Gaz Williams with 19.
Not bad.
Then it's Ronan King with 32.
That's over 50%. We're taking it.
Joint second place is Grant McIvor and Alex Webb with 50 points. Therefore, even if the Return of the Jedi question was disputed with 52 points, the winner is Brent Carter.
Can we do
I'm
one
sorry.
Real quick?
Oh,
real
no, quick, real I got, no, sorry. I'm just realizing if that question's wrong, it'll be 51 between Grant and Brent. So I think we need to go find out Blue Harvest.
Okay.
Cool. Let's start on.
Also, wait. See the question about the two qualifiers. Did Skinner specifically put Pete Dunne and Flash Morgan Webster?
He put two.
Pete Dunne.
I think Brent, Alex is in Brent, it as well. Then
Brent, you got that one wrong. So it's just 50. So let's.
I mean, if anything, Skinner got that wrong.
Well, if anything, Skinner was doing the question, so therefore you get it wrong.
Okay, this is a very controversial end to the podcast.
Are we looking up this?
I'm looking up Blue Harvest. Jedi. Yeah, I'm looking up Blue Harvest. Just to try and get. I'm going to use IMDb. That seems like a really safe. But I'm going to use Wikipedia because that seems like it's going to be controversial. God, I hate the internet. Okay. Blue Harvest was a fake working title used to hide the 1982 production of. Hang on, I've lost the picture. Blue Harvest was a fake working title used to hide the 1982 production of Star Wars Episode VI, Return of the Jedi, the third installment of the Star Wars film series. So that point still stands. So even if that Ian Skinner question is disputed, then Brent still wins by 1 point.
Cool.
So, there you go. That is.
Thank you.
I feel it is a big deflation because Alex was so passionate about shaving points off.
Yeah. Oh, it's fucking. I'm livid, Billy.
I know.
I'm livid.
Yes.
So the winner of the Day of Birth Bonanza number 3 for the third time running, it is the Fair City Hooligan PM, Brent Carter. He will be receiving this wonderful prize in the post at some point in the next 10 days or so.
Billy, thank you very much.
Sorry, you want what? Spoon? Oh, spoon and spoon.
At least get a wooden spoon.
No.
Fuck! Give him a fridge magnet for his home.
I might do that. Okay, I'll see if I can fund a fridge magnet. I think that seems to be the most appropriate gift for you.
I think 3 is enough. I'd like to retire from Day of Birth Bonanza for everyone's sake, because yeah.
So next year, I'm taking an extended break off the podcast, so I don't know if the Day of Birth Bonanza will return. It should return next year. But yeah, I'm taking a break from doing interviews as often as I do because I accept 200 odd episodes. I'm kind of spent a little bit.
If you do it next year, I'll do a round. But I think this has maybe ran its course.
So vacating as of next year will be Brent Carter. Obviously, once you hit 1,000 days.
Oh yeah,
the big Leo King way of relinquishing a title.
No, it's Leo Ironside now. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, whatever the fuck he's called.
Sorry, do you try and message folk to get them to get off before you get big headed? Oh, sorry, did I say that out loud? Shit.
Pop this on. Here we go.
Okay. So, thank you for everyone that's joined us for this amazing, tremendous quiz, Day of Birth Bonanza 3. Thank you to our winner, Brent Carter. I don't know if did you prepare a winner's speech? No. Brent, okay.
Fuck Omar. That's there.
Well, Brent's won more of these quizzes than he's had matches, but, you know, I can't really, you know.
That's not true.
So I've been joined by.
Absolutely.
I think we should all give Billy like a round of applause for doing like 200 plus episodes of the podcast, because he's like the one that's put this all together. So big thanks to Billy.
You won't get any extra points for that, Alex, but thank you. I've been joined by Alex Webb, Grant McIvor, Gaz Williams, Umar Mohammed, Tom Atlas, Ronan King, and of course the winner, Brent Carter. This has actually been a really fun kind of finale to the show. And like I said, we'll be some interviews in the future, but we'll be as regular as one a week. So it was also nice. I was glad that Omar messaged, because of course he was the first guest ever on the podcast. So to get him involved was really nice. So it's a nice bookend. If I don't do any more interviews, a nice bookend to have Omar on the first and last. But yeah, this has been the SWN podcast, Day of Birth Bonanza. If you've been playing along, if you have any takes on any of the answers that I got incorrect, remember, Ian Skinner Round, go to Ian Skinner directly. There'll be, anyone wants to plug their social media before we go? Ronan King's been doing it through the whole episode on the video. So, anyone know?
Professor of Islamonomics. You know, that I'll say that.
Cool. Tell me your scores.
I'm on my way back to the fridge. Thank you guys very much.
I'm retired. Follow at Running King on everything. Thanks.
Yes. Okay. Right. Goodbye.
My disappointment is immeasurable, and my day has been ruined.